Welcome to today's seminar. Today's speaker is Ping Hu. He was a student of Jerzy Balog at University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. Now he's second year postdoc at University of Warwick of Dunkerque, and he will be speaking about joint work with Andrei Greshik and Jan Molec, who was speaking last week. He will be talking about minimum number of edges in odd cycles.
Okay. Thank you for the introduction. So you can read the title Minimum Number of Edges in Odd Cycles, but of course it's not that complete title because you have to say in which graph you are looking at this problem, right? You're looking at odd cycles, you're looking at number of edges in odd cycles, and you want to ask in which family of graphs. So we start from which family of graphs. You want to look at the number of edges in odd cycles, so such family of graphs should have at least one odd cycle, right? So you may start with graphs with n squared over 4 plus 1 edges. And one of the fundamental theorem by Mantov says such graph would contain at least one triangle, right? After you know a graph with n squared over 4 plus 1 edges contain a triangle, you may ask how many triangles it has. Then Rademacher showed that actually, it contains at least n over 2 triangles instead of 1, and this is sharp, just by complete bipartite graph plus 1 edge. And then, after that, what question you can ask? Well, inspired by the, you may already know from the title of the talk, you may ask what the number of edges in triangles. So, Erd H, Faudree and Rousseau show that such graph contain at least 2 times n over 2 plus 1 edges that occur in a triangle. So roughly n edges, and it's still, say, this time it is still just linear number of edges occurring in a triangle. And again, this is sharp, and by the same example, you take a balanced complete bipartite graph plus 1 edge, right? And then, basically, if you want to have an edge occurring in a triangle, then you have to use that plus edge, so that's why you don't have too many edges. So then, what else can you say? Well, you can ask graph with more edges, but you still fix the number of edges, right? So instead of you say, I'm only looking at graphs with n squared over 4 plus 1 edges, you look at graph with fixed number of edges, say e edges, you fix the number e, and you want to ask the same question. And this time e should be at least n squared over 4 plus 1. So we say, okay, so basically we're studying this parameter, TR and E, the minimum number of edges that occur in a triangle among all graphs with N vertices and E edges. And what you expect this number to be? So in last slide, when you look at edges in triangles, the general example is you put one edge into a complete bipartite graph. Here, instead of you put one edge, you need to put more edges. Then, which extreme example you may think? A natural example is instead of put one edge, you put a clique. Say like this. I have a complete bipartite graph. Like here, I use white part to mean independent set and gray part to mean all possible edges. Right? So I have a complete bipartite graph here, and I put a clique here, I join all possible edges here. So this is a construction. By the way, I don't care about the sizes of these three parts. So for example, if this part, the complete part is zero, then it is actually just bipartite graph. And if both of these two white part is zero, then it is a clique. So it is quite some family of graphs. And I say, okay, let Gn of E be the same question, minimum number of edges that occur in a triangle, but instead of all graphs, I look at only graphs of this construction. And again, fixed number of vertices, fixed number of edges. And of course, because TRn of E is among all graphs, it is definitely less than equal to Gn of E. But actually, Faudree and Maleki show that they are not far away from each other. It is less than Gn of E, but also at least Gn of E minus 3 over 2. So these two parameters are roughly the same. And you can think, because, I mean, this 3 over 2 is just linear, so it is little o of n squared when you consider the density of edges. So you may think, in the limit sense or in the density sense, they are roughly the same if E is at least n squared over 4. Okay? So this is for triangles. And because of in the title I said odd cycles, so we should look at longer odd cycles. So L they show that a graph with n vertices, and this time we go back to graph with exact n squared over 4 plus 1 edges. For such graph, it contains at least 2 n squared over 9 edges that occur in some odd cycle. So instead of triangle, this time you look at some odd cycle, any odd cycle. So triangle C5, C7, any odd cycle. I will show that such graph contains at least 2 n squared over 9 edges that occur in some odd cycle. And this time, the behavior changes a lot, right? So for triangle, it's just linear, 2 times n over 2 plus 1. But for any odd cycle, it becomes 2 n squared over 9. And why is that? Because for triangle, you put one edge in a complete bipartite graph. And whenever you want to find the triangle, it must use that plus one edge. But this time, if you're looking at the same structure, then for example, for C5, you will find that any edge will occur in a C5. Because you just have that plus edge and you pick another edge, then you can just easily construct a C5 containing both edges. So if you look at that example, complete bipartite graph plus one edge, then all edges will be occurring in some C5. So that's one, that construction is not an extreme example for this one. So that's why the behavior changed a lot. And actually, this is also sharp by this example. You take a clique of size 2n over 3, you take a complete bipartite graph of size n over 3, and they join by a vertex. So join by a vertex is just to have the exact number here. So it doesn't matter. Just basically a clique and a complete bipartite graph. And this time, if you want to be in some odd cycle, you have to be in this clique. Just this. But this is in some odd cycle. What if we want to fix the length of odd cycles you want to study? This is conjectured by Erd H, Faudree and Rousseau, show that actually this number holds if you fix the length of odd cycle. Basically says for every k at least 2, because we have already studied triangle, we start from C5. So for every k at least 2, a graph with n vertices and n squared over 4 plus 1 edges contains at least 2 n squared over 9 edges that occur in C2k plus 1. Basically, it says if you fix the length of all cycles, say C5, you'll have this number of edges that occur in C5. And the same true for C7 and C9. Okay? So the conjecture clear? And unfortunately, this conjecture is not true. And which is, this is a counterexample for the case k equal to 2, which means for the C5 case. The conjecture says you need to have 2 n squared over 9 edges that are in C5, but this construction shows lesser. And this construction is like this. You have 4 parts. You have independent size, independent size, independent size, and a clique. And they join by all possible edges. And why this is a construction, this is a counterexample. So what's the idea behind this counterexample? The idea is you want to have edges that occur in C5, right? You want to have, this is the edges you try to minimize. So you want to say, okay, maybe I can find, say, a lot of edges not in C5, but in C7, say, because Erd H already proved that you have 2 n squared over 9 edges that occur in odd cycle. So if you want to minimize the number of edges in C5, you may say, okay, I may have some other edges in some other length of odd cycles. And see here, if you want to in an odd cycle, you have to use edges here, right? Because others are just complete bipartite graph. And then, if I want to be in C5, then you start from here, you go here, you go here, then you have to go back. Which means edges here are in C7, but not in C5. And this way, you get less than 2 n squared over 9 edges that occur in C5, which shows this counterexample. And of course, you can generalize this counterexample by adding one part here. So you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 parts, and edges here will be in C9, but not in C7. But this is not a counterexample, simply because it won't give you better than 2 n squared over 9 edges. So this type of construction only gives counterexamples for C5. And actually, asymptotically, this number is best possible. So Faudree and Maleki show that instead of you're looking at graph with fixed number of vertices, fixed number of edges, n squared over 4 plus 1, you look at edge density 1 over 4 plus little of 1, and then such graph would contain at least roughly the density suggested by the counterexample edges that occur in C5. So I don't really want to read it, but I should read it maybe once, 2 plus root 2 over 16 minus little of 1. And this is for C5. What about for longer off cycles? For longer off cycles, Faudree and Maleki show that the same type of asymptotic result, the conjecture is true asymptotically. So for any integer at least 3 means longer off cycles than C5, if a G on n vertices has, again, 1 quarter plus little of 1 n square edges, then G contains at least 2 ninths minus little of 1 n square edges that occur in a long out cycle C2k plus 1 of length 2k plus 1, say C7, C9, any fixed length, at least 7. But the question asked by the conjecture is graphs of size of 1 quarter n squared plus 1 edges instead of little of 1. So we are able to prove that case. So we prove that if a graph G on n vertices has exactly n squared over 4 plus 1 edges, then G contains at least 2 plus root 2 over 16 minus little of 1 n squared edges that occur in C5. And the same is the same type of result for C7, C9, longer off cycles. We say that for such graphs, it contains at least 2 over 9 minus little of 1 n squared edges that occur in C2k plus 1. So is the result clear so far? So this is about the density part, right? So for a extremal problem, you first ask, say, the extremal number, right? And after you know the extremal number, what you want to know next? You want to know something like, you want to know the structure of the extremal graph, or extremal structures. And before you look at the exact extremal structures, you may first start with the stability result. So that's what we did. We show that if a G on n vertices has roughly n squared over 4 edges, and out of which roughly this number of edges occur in C5, then your graph G must be look very similar to the counterexample or the extremal structure suggested. By very similar, I mean you can just add, remove a little bit of edges to make it look exactly as this. And the same is true for longer off cycles. We show that if a graph G on n vertices has roughly n squared over 4 edges, and out of them roughly 2 9 n squared edges occur in some off cycle C2k plus 1, you fix k, then the G is very close to this construction, a clique and a complete bipartite graph of a certain size, 2 n over 3 and n over 3. Okay? And to prove this, we use algorithms, but I want to show you the exact proof, but I will show you some flavors of the proof. So it basically help you to prove some inequalities. So I will show you something, say for example, whenever I have a graph, I will not only see it as a graph, but I will also view it as a density, means the property is that three random vertices in G span a right triangle. And here I just assume G is two colored, red and blue. And you can also think G as just a graph. Say, for example, red is edges and blue are non-edges, something like that. So it's, yeah. So basically, this means it's just induced density of triangle. And yeah, so for example, I can have two blue and one red, and it's just a property that three vertices span this. And instead of just this, I can say I can fix a vertex. Say here, in graph G, I fix a vertex V, and then I just look at, so basically this vertex is fixed, and then I just randomly choose another vertex. And I look at the probability that this happens, and this is basically just a degree of V. Right? if you view right edges as edge, or let's say right degree of V divided by N. Okay. So, but usually you just view this as a density. And we look at some, because it is called flat algebra, so there's something about algebra. So there's something about plus minus multiplication. So let's see something. For example, I say 1 is this. What does that mean? It means if I look at 3 vertices, then the density for any graph G, the density of these 4, the summation of density of these 4 is 1. Basically, because if G is 2 color, you look at 3 vertices, it must induce one of these 4 cases. Right?
So you have complete graph that is 2 edge colored, that's what you have?
Yes. I have a. So G is a. Yeah, G is a complete graph with with edges being 2 colored. Or you can think G is a graph. But red edges mean edge, blue edges mean non-edge, something like that. And instead of just say 1, you can ask more. For example, if I want to ask what is the red edge density of a graph G, instead of just say, okay, I randomly choose 2 vertices, I look at the probability that these 2 vertices give me a red edge, I can first randomly choose 3 vertices. And then out of these 3 vertices, I choose another 2 vertices. So I can say, okay. So for example, what does that mean? It means I first randomly choose 3 vertices. It will give me one of these 4 cases. And then I look at out of each, what's the probability that I choose another 2 vertices, it gives me a red edge. For example, for this one, it is 3/3 because it has 3 red edges. And this one, it is 2/3, and the last one is just 0/3 because it is a blue triangle. So basically, you randomly choose 2 vertices, you have 3 choices. And you just look at the probability that it gives you a red edge. So this is, if you want to prove it, it's just some simple double counting for any graphs, for any complete graphs, 2 color. Okay. And yeah, and because this is 0, you can just remove it. And now I have product. Right, because I said it's algebra, so you need to have some product. So I say, okay, so for example, I fix the vertex V, and then I look at the product. So what does that mean? It means I fix the vertex V, I choose one vertex, so that vertex induces a red edge, I choose another vertex, that edge reduces a blue edge. So it should give me this, right? It should give me basically this structure. I have a fixed vertex V, one edge blue, another edge, one edge red, another edge blue, and I don't care about the color of this edge. It means it can be either red or blue. And why I have this one half? Because in the product it says, basically I said, the first vertex I choose gives me red, the second vertex I choose gives me blue. But here I don't care about the order. You can think of this like blue times red is the same as red times blue, and their sum is this structure. So each one of them is just half of it, because I don't care about the order you choose these 2 vertices. You can always think it as in a graph. For example, if you fix a vertex V, then the red degree density times the blue degree density is exactly this. So means you look at this density, means you fix the vertex V, you always fix this, and you look at, you randomly choose another 2 vertices, the probability that it gives you this structure times 1/2 plus 1/2 of the probability it gives you this structure, the summation will be, and there's some little of a difference, will be the product of this. So whenever you see something like this, you just think of it as a density in some large graph G. And this coefficient is just to make the equality hold. But I think if you don't care about the coefficients, then it makes more sense, right? Because it's just say I have a red edge, I have a blue edge, they share a vertex. So if I look at their product, it should give you this structure.
Why there is a difference, the small difference? What?
Oh, because, for example, here, I choose a vertex, I choose another vertex, there's a small chance that you choose two vertices be the same.
Oh.
Right? Uh-huh. But here, I choose two different vertices. That's why there is a small difference.
Okay. Thank you.
So, you see, this is the probability of choosing two vertices, U1, U2, other than V. Then first is red, second is blue, and then this is just choose two different vertices. Okay. So this is clear. So just give you some simple plus and product of this algebra. And for example, you can do this. This is right times right, and this times I don't have this coefficient 1/2 because they are the same. I choose the first one is right, second one is also right. So, and because this little of one just comes from the probability that you choose two vertices be the same, so it goes to zero as n go to infinity.
So you could say that the coefficient there is 2 out of 2.
Yes,
I mean,
the coefficient
implicit,
is...
really,
yeah.
The 2 being the denominator is important because...
Right, yeah, it is 2 over 2. So to give you some idea how I use this, I will show a proof using flat algebras of Mantel theorem. It may be the most complicated proof of Mantel theorem that we'll see. So Mantel theorem says that if I have n squared over 4 plus 1 edges, then it contains a triangle. And I want to use the red-blue edge-colored language to say this. And how do I say this? I say, okay, if red triangle is 0, then red edge density is less than or equal to 1/2. So you can think red edge means edge, blue edge means non-edge. Then this says, if I don't have triangle, then edge density is less than or equal to 1/2. So this is exactly the Mantel theorem in the limit sense. Okay, and how do I prove it? Well, I first start with the equality I showed before. I say, okay, right edge density, you can write it as a linear combination of graphs on three vertices. And because this time I have condition that right triangle is zero, so the first term is actually zero, so I only have the last two terms. And I say, this is less than 2/3. Why? Because the summation of these four is 1. So you can see here, this is less than 2/3 times this 4. Okay, basically. So now, it shows you a very simple proof that instead of less than equal to 1/2, you know that if it is triangle free, then the edge density is less than equal to 2/3. And how do you improve this to 1/2? Well, for example, if I can show this, I can show inequality something is greater than or equal to 0, then I will just sum this to this side, right? I say, okay, so basically I say 0 plus red edge is a red edge, and then 2/3 minus 1/6, 1/3 plus 1/6, and then 1/2 here, and then you can check this is half, this is half, this is 1/2, so the summation is less than or equal to 1/2. Okay, so if I can show this inequality, then I'm done. And flat algebra just give you a way to find, to prove this inequality. And how to prove this? Well, which one in mathematics is the most obvious way to get something greater than or equal to zero? What is a, you take a square. Okay, you take square of anything, it is at least zero. So I take this square, 1 minus, so I fix the vertex v, I say 1 minus 2 times the red edge, but it fixes the vertex v. And you may forget about, you don't have to check the computation, I just say, okay, this square is at least 0, but this is fixed vertex v. So for any vertex v, it is greater than or equal to 0, and on average, it is still greater than or equal to 0, okay, because it is square. And then you can say, okay, I can run computation, you can just run the previous computation to show that it is actually this by algebra, and because red is 0, so you don't have this term, and you have only this, and if you expand 1, expand the right edge as before, as a linear combination of graph on three vertices, you will have this. And you can see here, if I take half of this, you will get something like that. Okay? So if I take half of this plus the right edge, you will get this, and this is less than equal to 1/2. And which part? So you don't have to check the computation, just give an idea. Basically, I say a right edge plus a square. And after adding this square, I magically show that it is less than equal to 1/2. So the magical part is the square, right? So you want to find this square such that you have 1/2. And this part is you can find it by flag algebra. I won't show you the details how flag algebra help you to find the square, but it's just some computer assisted things to help you find it. And in this way, flag algebra help you to prove some inequalities. And actually, it can tell you more. So assume I have triangle density 0 and edge density at least 1/2. And then we know, so this is an inequality proved by flag algebra. And you also assume it is at least 1/2. Then what it tells? It tells you that half is less than or equal to half minus 1/3 of a quaternary. You can see because this is 1/6, you just take 1/2 minus this. And this implies that the quaternary density is 0. Okay. Simply because it just runs simple algebra. And it actually can tell you the structure. Because quaternary density is 0, you start from a right edge, and then you can say, okay, I pick another edge, and then I have to have this, and I can have this, and I can build up the complete bipartite graph. Okay. So instead of just showing the density, it also tells you something about the structure. Namely, it tells you some structure has density 0. Okay. So in summary, so flag algebra can prove some inequalities for certain family of graphs. By certain family, I mean, for example, for that example, it is say triangle density is 0, and instead of proving inequalities, it can also show some structure. Means you can show for some graph H, its density is 0 in the extremal structure. Okay. So I will use these two information to give you an idea of the proof. So what you can try is this. Okay. So basically, you give a family of graphs and you ask some inequality, try to prove it. For example, again, I have red-blue colored graph G. And what problem we are working on? We are working, say, okay, I look at edges that in C7. Okay? But it's somehow hard to say some edges in C7, but it's easy to say blue edges. So let's say red edge is in C7. Blue edge is not in C7. So I say, blue edge is not in C7, what is the minimum number of red edge? So that's the question I'm asking. And so basically, because blue edge is not in C7, if you want to minimize the number of red edges should in C7.
Right. Yes. So now it's not a complete graph?
No, sorry. Yeah, so basically this time I look at any graph, G, and so basically it has three types of edges, non-edge, red edge, and blue edge. And this is a question basically exactly the same as the conjecture.
And n squared over 4 is red edges and blue edges together.
Yes, thank you. But the flag algebra can only deal with edge density, so basically you can ask such things. And so these two cases, we deal with them separately. If the first case, then we are done. If the second case, you can show that because it has little o of n cubed triangles, and it has n squared over 4 plus 1 edges. Using these two conditions, we show that G is very close to a bipartite graph, and almost all edges are in C7. And almost all edges is definitely more than 2 n squared over 9, so we have got a proof. Okay? So this is the idea of the proof. Instead of just asking what you can say about the lower bound of a red edge, we ask something else, which gives us one of these two holds. And what question we ask? I will show you now. So we say, okay, same setup. n2 over 4 plus 1 h, blue h is not in C7, and we actually say something more about the graph G. Say blue h is not in C7, but we can show that blue h is actually in not in more structures. For example, it is you cannot have a triangle with a blue h. Why is that? Simply because if G, so we consider a large graph G, if G has a positive density of such structure, then it will have a blow up of this structure. And the blow up of this triangle will contain a C7 with blue edge. So this structure must have little of 1 density or say 0 density in the limit sense. And the same as this. So if a structure, the blow up of the structure contains C7, then it has little of 1 density in G.
So the black edge is for anything.
Ah, right, thank you. So the black edge is for, I don't care about the color. Black edge means I don't care about the colors of that edge. But yes?
So you use the word blow up, which makes me think that the little O of 1 or the N behavior, in order for you to properly prove this, would require the regularity lemma and therefore N to be that large?
No.
No?
Let's say. I think the basically the proof is like the transdensity of a three-part type graph is zero, right? So I mean for three uniform type of graph, for the triangle case is that. So I think, I don't know if that proof requires regularity lemma or not.
I don't believe so. I think it predates the regularity.
Yeah.
It's
Erd H. Yeah, Erd H. But I mean, for general, I don't know. So,
yeah.
So I'm not sure if the.
I don't think there's anything quite so nice.
Yeah. But, yeah. Then we can say, okay. Instead of just say blue edge is not in C7, we can have more conditions. And then, instead of asking the red edge, we have shown this. Red edge minus 4.9 times red triangle is at least 0. So what does this tell us? So this inequality. This inequality says, okay, I have two cases. The first case, red triangle is 0. Which by the proof it says, okay, if red triangle is 0, it has little of 1 density. And by the number of edges, it is close to a bipartite graph, and I have almost all edges in C7. And if red triangle is positive, then because of this inequality is non-negative, the second part must also be non-negative. So I have red edges being at least 4/9. So this inequality, this product inequality, implies that two cases. Either red edge be at least 4/9 or triangle density being 0. And then we deal with them, the two cases separately, we got the proof. So remember that in the introduction to flag algebra tells you that instead of just proving an inequality, it can also tell you some information about the primal graph. Namely, it can tell you that for some small graph, its density is 0 in the primal structure. And we use that to prove the stability result. Okay? So just remind you that the stability result is showing that if G on n vertices has roughly n squared over 4 edges, 2 over 9 n squared edges occur in some odd cycle C2k+1, then it is close to this structure, click and bipartite graph. And we show that some graph has density 0. And what we show is this. So if I have red edge being at least 4/9, means the general case, and edge density being 1/2, so this two is the general case, then P4 is 0. By P4, I mean any color, any two edge color of P4, and it is induced density being 0. Means I look at four vertices, I cannot find the induced copy of P4, of any two color P4. So instead of just showing that inequality at 0, it also tells me that if these two conditions hold, then I cannot see these structures. And I use this additional information to get stability result. Basically, I say, okay, I have this being 0, I also have this being 0, because they are blow up condensed C7 from the previous slide. And so you can see I have a lot of information about the dreamer structure. So I first say, okay, I apply induced remove lemma to say, okay, instead of little O of fine density, I change little O of n square edges to make them does not appear in the dreamer structure. And then I just partition the vertices under certain rules. Yes?
When you say induced removal lemma, is this something you had to invent for this paper, or is something that's developed over time?
It's already developed. So basically, so removal lemma says you look at the density, right? But the induced removal lemma says you look at the induced density.
Okay.
So just,
is this a flag algebra type lemma, or are we talking about
No, it's just irregularity, yeah.
Okay.
So induced removal lemma says, yeah, you can remove some edges to make the induced density being zero. Okay. And so we partition the vertices to try to find the partition saying one part is a clique, the other part is a bipartite graph. And then we are done. So how we partition the vertices is like this. We say A is a vertex that are incident to a blue edge or have a neighbor that is incident to a blue edge. And B is the other vertices. And then you just use this information to say, okay, actually this partition is a red partition. I won't show you the detail of the proof, but basically we show in this step. We first show that G of A is a bipartite. And we also show no edges between A and B. And you can also show some sides that none of AB are empty, something like that. And then you use optimization to show that the red number for A and B to move, give you this red edge being 49 is n over 3, and B is 2 n over 3. And G of B is a clique. OK? And yeah, and that's the end. Thank you.
Are there some questions for Bill?
Yes.
Mine will be very annoying. Does anybody have other questions that are less annoying? So can we get back to the statement of your theorem? Probably all the way back to the beginning.
Which
main theorem? One that goes in the abstract. Okay, yes. So how difficult do you think it is to get rid of the little O of 1?
So we have the stability result, right?
Yes.
So from the stability result, you can go to the exact result, which I think is not very hard. We are working on that. But the problem is, even if with the exact result, would say, okay, so if I have n squared over 4 of plus 1 edges, and I have the dreamer number of edges, then my graph would look exactly as the dreamer structure, right?
Yes.
But the problem is, for example, for this dreamer structure, you have 2 minus root 2 over 4.
Yes.
So you somehow want to say, okay, I want to maximize the number of edges in this structure. Or say,
yes.
I want to maximize the number of edges that is in, say, I want to in C5, something like that. But because of this root 2, so it's, you can somehow only do the asymptotic optimization. So,
rounding off, right?
Yeah, so there, you need to basically deal with the rounding very carefully. And so basically, even if you know the structure is exactly like this, then
but
just
then I'm happy. Actually.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You
yeah,
tell
yeah.
me I have empty set.
Yeah,
set,
yeah, yeah.
Main,
so I think it's maybe not hard to prove that after you achieve the dreamer number, the structure would be exactly like this. I think from stability to the exact result is not hard. Just showing the right number is, so you basically you say, okay, I have this number, I have this structure, I want to run an optimization problem to get the right number, but
yeah, that's only 4 variables, so somehow,
yeah,
that's the easier part.
Yeah, yeah,
you have
I
a
mean,
lot
if
more
you
variables.
Fix, no, I'm saying if you fix, and then it may be easy, but if you have a general, you need to deal with
it.
Yeah,
you have to divide by n and
yeah, yeah.
solving it.
Yeah, yeah.
I see the issue there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
but
maybe
you might be able to prove some sort of monotone thing where you have a structure, and if you increase or decrease any of them anything, then it changes in the wrong way.
Yeah.
Yeah, I see that major issue.
So we are working on proving the exact result. No.
Any other questions? Are you satisfied?
Oh, I was satisfied earlier on. I was just curious as to what's next.
So let's think pink again.